First of all, I want to thank Joanna and all the organizers of this very nice meeting for giving me the opportunity to speak about this work. Second, I want to thank my great collaborators, Domenico Seminara from Florence and Jacopo Sisti, my student Tissot, who is around and who really made the hard part of the work behind this project. He's also presenting a poster on these results, so if you're interested, please find him. So, in this talk, I will discuss the computational holographic entanglement entropy in the old-fashioned way, Ryutaka-Yanagi way, particularly in the simplest setup, where the shape of the region does matter, which is a DS4-CFT3. The first part of the talk, I will discuss the case of ADS4-CFT3, discussing these two topics, Willmore function and Kornel function, and then in the second part, I will extend this approach to the case where the dual CFT has a boundary. Okay, so this is just the definition of entanglement entropy. I will skip it. This, fortunately, Michael gave a great review before. So entanglement, this is the quantity we are interested in. So the von Neumann entropy of the reduced density matrix for a spatial bipartition of the system. I want to stress the fact that A can be made by this joint region, but it's always a bipartition of the inverse space. And I will use basically the Ryutaka-Yanagi formula, which tells that if you fix the region in the boundary, then the leading order in the large n limit of entanglement entropy is computed by evaluating the area of the minimal surface anchored to the boundary of A. And in particular, if your bulk geometry is four-dimensional, then you can expand the area in this way. This is the famous area law that Michael talked about. But in this talk, I will focus on the subleading term, which I call FA, which is very important, first of all, because it is sensible to the entire surface, while this PA is the perimeter of this length, of the length of this curve, the perimeter. While so this part is sensible only to this part of the surface, while the subleading term, if you want to say something about that, you need to know the entire surface. And then I have to say that analytically, people addressed only simple domains. And here, instead, we want to say something about a generic shape. So first, we use a numerical tool, which is based on this code, Surface Evolver, which is available online, has been developed by Ken Bracke, and it works like this. So suppose that you first fix the curve, which is a disk in this case. You give a trial, you give some point in the bulk as a starting point of your evolution, and then you let the evolution run. And then the code minimize the area by approximating the final continuous curve, continuous surface, which we know is an hemisphere, as a triangulated surface. Okay? So this is just a simple example, but of course, now you can easily understand that with this tool, you can study basically all the possible shapes, which are very difficult to address analytically, even this joint case, like this case of two ellipses. So this is from the numerical point of view, but from the analytic result, we have some analytic result which is related to this Willmore energy. So Willmore energy is a well-known function in mathematics. It's defined like this. Suppose that you have a smooth genus G Riemann surface in R3, and then the Willmore energy is just defined by integrating over the surface the mean curvature, the trace of this K tilde is the extrinsic curvature of this embedding. This is a well-known function in mathematics. And it has something to do with our problem, because if you take the Ryutaka-Yanagi surface, for instance, in H3, in the case where the ground state is a vacuum, this is a minimal surface, so the trace of K, the extrinsic curvature, is zero in the hyperbolic space. But if you now think of this surface as embedded in R3, it turns out Babic and Bobenko in the 90s found that the subleading term that we are interested in is basically given by the Willmore functional of this surface as embedded in R3. Of course, you can double it. This is z equals zero if you just reflect and you join. This is one half of the Wilmer functional of this closed surface, which has the peculiarity that there is a z2 symmetry here, and then more importantly, this line is umbilic, which means that the two principal curvatures of the surface along this line are equal. Now that you have this analytic result, you can use what is known in mathematics about this functional. In particular, it's not difficult to show that for any genus G Riemann surface, this function is always bigger than 4 pi. And if you translate in this holographic context, this means that if you take any region, you fix the perimeter and you change the shape, the subleading, the area law term is the same. The subleading term changes, and it's always bigger than 2 pi, and this 2 pi is reached when the region is a disk. So this is a result for any shape. Okay. The good point is that you can apply this business also when you have corner. So this is the triangle. This is the minimal surface attached to the triangle. In this case, there is an extra logarithmic divergence, and which is very important because the coefficient here is determined by the so-called corner function. You have to sum over the vertices, the value of the corner function evaluated on the opening angles. And this is the analytic expression found by Druck and Grossugur many years ago, and we checked that this can be reproduced. This is the numerical analysis for this for this domain, and in particular, so this is the Drucker-Grossugur analytic function, this is the numeric, and this curve is interesting because if you look at this region here, few years ago, people found a nice relation between this coefficient, which is the expansion close to pi, of the corner function and the two-point function of the stress tensor. Particular, this coefficient of the expansion is basically proportional to this constant of the CFT3. Then we generalize this result of Wilmer function to a generically asymptotic ADS4 space. In this case, the three-dimensional metric G mu nu can be written in this way, where this is a conformal factor, this is an asymptotically flat metric, and then it turns out that you can write the finite term in terms of this asymptotically flat metric, G tilde. So this is the Wilmer functional term, and then there are these extra term where this covariant derivative is evaluated with respect to this metric. So this is a perfectly finite functional, which generalizes, if you want, the Wilmer functional to the case of black holes, etc. So this is an example of an ellipsis in a black brain geometry with mass m and q. This is the expression of the finite term, which depends on the blackening factor here, f. And you have to integrate over the entire surface this expression, where this vector is a z component of the normal vector to the Ryu-Takahashi surface. And this is the result, the numerical check that if you have extremal ADS4, Schwarzschild ADS4 black hole for these are two ellipses and the disk, the Wilmer functional approach and the area approach gives you the same result. So it's a check of this analytic formula. So now we are gonna extend this result to the case to the setup of ADS4 BCFT3. In particular, we take the setup introduced by Takei and Haji some years ago, where the gravitational action is given by the usual part, and then you introduce a brain which arrives to the boundary here. This is the extrinsic curvature, and then you allow to have some matter on the brain. You have to let me mention that many people also in the audience contributed to this kind of analysis in the presence of boundary, in particular also Johanna and collaborator, Andy, Andreas Karch, and Chris Herzog here in the audience. But here I want to focus on this holographic approach, where basically the gauge T, the boundary theory as a boundary itself, and then this brain is attached to the boundary and extend in the bulk in a way which is dictated by this action here. So you first determine this brain, depending on the matter that you put on it, and then you can study your preferred quantity inside this volume. So in the simplest setup, you put a constant on the brain, and then it turns out that this brain is just an hyperplane where alpha is this angle here. So here we're interested in particular in the entanglement entropy. So the first, and then we made a Ryu Takahanagi kind of calculation. The first difference is that if you expand the area, this is not the perimeter anymore of the region, depends on the kind of region. Suppose that your region is attached to the boundary. What matters is the length of the entangling curve, in particular the red curve here, and you don't have to consider this part which is shared with the boundary. But again, you can ask what is the subleading term. If you apply the same analysis to this case, you find again that you can write analytically this subleading term in this form. There is a surface integral, which is basically the same one that I discussed before, but then there is also an extra boundary term which is evaluated on the intersection between the Ryu Takahanagi surface and the brain. This B is the vector orthogonal to this intersection. If you specialize, so this is a generic formula for any asymptotically DS4 background. If you specialize it to the simplest case where you have a vacuum, you get the Wilmore functional plus this boundary term. Okay, so now let's see. Of course, you can use Evolver also in this case, and this is the kind of evolution that you find. So first you fix the region, and then you evolve. The intersection, it's important to stress that the intersection along the brain is orthogonal here. And then you can play with the shapes and study all this kind of thing. In particular, you can study the corner function. This is what we did in this paper. When you have intersection between the boundary and the entangling curve, you have this kind of corner function where the angle share only the tip with the boundary, or you can study region disjoint from the boundary. And in this case, it's easy to realize that there are transitions, because if this region is far from the boundary, you don't see the brain, but if it's close enough, you get attached. Okay, so this is qualitative. Let's see some quantitative results. The simplest domain you can think about are infinite strip attached to a flat boundary. This is what happens if you fix the region and then you move the angle of the brain. There is this interesting fact that enters, that has been first found out by Nagasaki and collaborated many years ago, namely the fact that this is Z star is the position of the intersection between the minimal surface and the brain. Here you see that there is this expression in a function of this corner, and this G alpha here is this complicated expression here, which becomes zero at some point, which means that this Z star goes to infinity, and then this corresponds to this red plane, and below this red plane, the minimal surface is this one, the vertical one. By the way, this is the same setup that Charlotte discussed in her talk, and so there is a critical angle in this business, which tells that something happens if you want to interpret this alpha as a parameter describing holographically the space of allowed boundary condition. So this is for the profile of the Ryu Takahanagi surface, and this is the expression for the entanglement entropy. It is negative in this regime, and below the critical angle, it becomes zero. We checked that you can find this expression both with the usual calculation of the area and with this Wilmore functional. And importantly, it's important to consider the line integral over the intersection. So this is the simplest example. We also address analytically this other example, which is a disk disjoint from a flat boundary. You can use conformal transformation to relate these two geometry. So basically, if you take a disk with a disjoint from a flat boundary, you can map it into a disk concentric to a circular boundary, and then you have to study these minimal surfaces. Basically, this is the situation. If you fix your disk, you have three solutions. One is the disconnected solution, which is just the hemisphere. And there are two solutions connected to the boundary, and you have to find which one is the minimal one. This is what happens if you fix, this is the comparison between our analytic, you can find analytic expression and compare with surface evolver, you see they agree. And the intersection here between the brain and the minimal surface is orthogonal, and then, so then you can think that this is a reduction of a problem in CF3 of an annulus, right? You can ask, okay, this is how we solve it. This is just to show you the kind of complication of the analytic solution. There are bunches of elliptic function, but not so complicated. This is the comparison for the now for the subleading term of the entanglement entropy. These are the analytic solution and the comparison with source versus evolver calculation computed in these two ways, they perfectly agree. And this is where the intersection between this curve and this horizontal line, which is 2 pi, gives you the transition between connected and disconnected solution. And in particular, this is the curve of the transition in terms of alpha, as a function of alpha. This is again the analytic expression. So if you compute the area of this disk, this is the area low term, and then the subleading term depends, you have to maximize between the disconnected solution, which is 2 pi, and the connected one, and this is the analytic expression of the connected one. You see that this is for various alpha, and that at the same critical alpha that I discussed before, you find this interesting behavior that basically below the critical alpha, you have the minimal surface is the disconnected one, always. Okay, this is just some picture to appreciate what happens. If you fixed your disk and then you move your plane, this is the shadow surface that you can construct because this problem is similar to the problem of two disjoint disk in CFT3. And this is a case when you fix alpha, you fix the brain, and you move the circle far away from the boundary. Then, of course, the beauty of this approach is that we can deal with generic shapes. And in particular, for instance, you can consider ellipses. These are two ellipses with different orientation, and you can find all this kind of numerical result. Yeah, these are numerical, but it would be great to have some analytic expression. Okay, finally, in the final 5 minutes, I want to discuss in details the case where you are considering region with corner adjacent to the boundary. So this is the simplest case of an infinite wedge of opening angle gamma adjacent to this boundary. So this is the brain, and this is the minimal surface that you construct when you have this case. This capital L is the length of this wedge, which is very large. Okay, in this case, you have the area low term, and again, the logarithmic divergence. The coefficient now is the corner function, which is more complicated because now depends not only on the opening angle, but also on the angle of your brain, which depends on the boundary condition that you have introduced in the CFT. This is the simplest example of an half disk. In this case, gamma is pi over 2. You can analytically find this result. It's very simple. In this case, the corner function is this simple function. But of course, using surface evolver, we can evaluate this kind of area, generic angle. And we also found an analytic expression for this corner function. And check that the Wilmore-like formula that I discussed before reproduced this analytic expression. This is the kind of analytic expression that you find. It's written parametrically. Okay, it's difficult, but not terribly difficult. You can deal with it. And this is the plot of the corner function in terms of the opening angle, which goes between 0 and pi over 2. So for alpha, for different values of alpha, the dot correspond to a numerical check that we made with different kind of surfaces. Okay, and I agree, so this is a very nice check that the analytic expression that I showed, it's okay. So for alpha equal pi over 2, which is this black line, you recover the Drucker, Gross and Auguri formula. But then for if you move alpha, you have this other curve. And very interesting, you find that for the alpha critical value of alpha that I introduced for strips, you find this this behavior that basically you don't have the divergence anymore, but here the intersection is finite. You can take, you can study analytically the asymptotics of this corner function as the opening angle goes to zero or pi over two, and these are the behavior. You see the same function that I introduced for the strips enters also in this case. And then, interesting, I want to focus on this regime close to pi over 2, which is this part here, which, because if I think in terms of the result of Bueno-Myers, this should give some information about some universal information about the BCFT. Particularly, turns out that if you compute the one-point function of the stress tensor of a BCFT3, when you have a curved boundary, this is something that Deutsch and Candelas introduced many years ago. You can expand this one-point function in terms of the proper distance from the boundary in this way, where this is the traceless part of the extrinsic curvature, and there is this coefficient, AT. We made this calculation holographically using the standard Balasubramanian-Krauss approach, and then we compared with this coefficient here, and we found that if you take this ratio between this coefficient and this second derivative of the expansion of the corner function, this dependence on the boundary condition cancel and you get to pi. Okay, so this gives you an hint that this corner function is sensible to some non-trivial data of the dual BCFT3, but it would be nice to test this relation in actual QFT model. And finally, we can address also the case of a corner function where the edge is not attached to the boundary. And in this case, clearly you have transition again, because take the symmetric case, which is this drop where the opening angle is omega, and then gamma are these two angles in the gray part. So clearly, if omega is very small, the minimal surface is not attached to the brain, but if it's large enough, it attaches to the brain, and so there is a transition at some critical value, which depends on alpha. Particularly if you move alpha, you see that this critical value changes. So we can study the value, this transition point in terms of alpha, the slope of this brain between alpha critical and pi, and this is the curve that we found numerically. But in general, you can also think about this. The most generic case is when you move also this to corner, and then you have a more complicated problem, because now you have two independent variables. One is the opening angle, and the other is the position with respect to the boundary. Again, you have transition, and now this is the diagram of the function of this critical configuration as a function of the opening angle and the distance. Okay, so the conclusion is that I discussed some holographic calculation of entanglement entropy in ADS4 BSCFT3 relating to the result to this Wilmore functional. And there are many open problems one can think about, like going to higher dimension, relating to what Charlotte discussed, and also I think that would be nice to understand better connection with mathematician, but okay, thank you.
Thank you, Eric, for an interesting talk and the funny shapes of the surfaces. Other questions? Yeah, please. K
whole
square?
You can. No, I don't know. I don't know. You can relate this to the, because the, this is the mean curvature. There is the Gaussian curvature, which is the mean curvature is the mean between the principal curvature at any point. The Gaussian curvature is the product. So, and the Gaussian curvature is the one that enters, it gives the topological term, is the one that gives you the Gauss-Bonnet term, right? So this is, if you want, this trace K is the non-trivial part. You can relate the two, but the difference is just a topological term. So yeah, it's probably the same, but the, yeah, there was a, yeah, a question there. Sorry, can you repeat, please? Yeah. A single point in the bulk, in the boundary? No, you cannot. Ah, no, but this program you can do whatever, depends on what you want to minimize. You can minimize also inside the bulk, you can have a point and then, yeah, you just give a trial, an initial thing, and then you, you insert the functional that you want to minimize, in this case the area, and then it gives you the shape. Yeah, it depends, yeah, yeah. Can use it.